Welcome to the motherfucking relay. We're covering today's top boxing news. Ow!
Delphine Pashoon versus Melissa St. Ville. Let's talk about the fight. You know, this was a step up in competition from the girls that the WBC lightweight champion Delphine Pashoon. This was a step up in competition from the kind of girls that she'd been fighting in the previous year. Melissa St. Ville is a more live animal, a more capable fighter than Delphine Pashoon's last two or three opponents. But Delphine Pashoon proved why she's still the reigning WBC lightweight champion. She proved effectively that she's still a force to be reckoned with, in spite of the fact that her last couple of opponents have been lackluster. Let's talk about the aesthetic of the fight. You know, this was a messy fight. This was a scrappy fight. There was a lot of infighting, a lot of wrestling, a lot of tussling.
On both sides.
There were clean shots getting through here and there for both girls, but essentially the aesthetic of the fight was a messy kind of fight. And in spite of Melissa St. Ville's best efforts to try to take that title away from the reigning champion, I think this proved to be too physically arduous, too physically taxing a fight for her to continue, for her to not only go the distance, but actually win this thing. Melissa St. Ville had quite a tall order in front of her in this fight with Delphine Pashoon, because not only are you taking on the longest reigning champion in the lightweight division, but this girl's actually a sizable puncher, so what punches do get through will inflict damage. Even when the punches, you know, even when the clean punches are far and few, what punches do get through can inflict serious damage. And I think it's more than Melissa St. Ville was equipped to deal with. Early in the fight, the action seemed about even between both fighters. Shots getting through for both fighters. Both fighters circling the ring, showing some movement, showing their jabs. But little by little, you saw that Melissa St. Ville was starting to fade. She was starting to wilt, starting to slow down. At one point in the fight, Delphine caught her with a right hand that sent her reeling into the turnbuckle. And this was an indicator that Melissa St. Ville is all but out of steam. And this was due to the come-forward aggressiveness of Delphine Pashoon. Delphine Pashoon, who believes in her power, who likes to pressure her opponents into situations to where she can land meaningful punches. For all Melissa St. Ville's virtues, she's really not in the same realm. In terms of power, she's really not in the same realm, not in the same league, as Delphine Pashoon in terms of power. So you're tasked with keeping up with an opponent that is attempting to pressure you into exchanges, and you don't really got the punching power to get their respect, to keep them honest, and to keep them off. I think this proved to be more than Melissa St. Ville was equipped to deal with. This isn't like the Wahlstrom fight, you know. Eva Wahlstrom is a skilled fighter, hands down. But she's not a very big puncher, so Melissa St. Ville, having gone the distance with her, is not the same kind of situation as trying to go the distance and win against Delphine Pashoon. Against Delphine Pashoon, you're facing a sizable puncher, and you're either going to have the skill to work around that power or match it.
Fighting fire with fire.
Melissa St. Ville wasn't able to do either of those things, and bear in mind that this fight went down in Delphine Pashoon's backyard. It was a tall ask of Melissa St. Ville to take this fight and try to win this thing. It shows a lot of courage. It shows that she's a road warrior, that she's not going to shy away from a challenge, but ultimately winning the fight,
too much working against,
is quite another matter. You know, when you're facing a reigning champion, and you just so happen to be facing that reigning champion in their backyard, it behooves you to take the decision out of the judge's hands, to try to win the fight by way of knockout to avoid any funny business. But for Melissa St. Ville, therein lied a dilemma, that Melissa St. Ville's really not a knockout puncher. She's not a big puncher. For all her virtues, she really doesn't pack the kind of power that could have sealed the deal against Delphine Pashoon. So her going over there and trying to win this fight, it was a tall order. I mean, when your best bet to win the fight in and of itself is a long shot, that's pretty much telling the story. So, you know, with these things in mind, it's not hard to understand why the fight ended the way that it did. Melissa St. Ville retired in her corner after six rounds of action. She couldn't go on anymore. This thing got stopped. With that, Delphine Pashoon retains her WBC lightweight title, advances to a professional record of 42 wins with only one loss, meaning she is still in the running for the winner of the Katie Taylor versus Rose Volante unification fight, which is going to be going down very soon. So keep your eyes peeled for the winner of that fight. For now, congratulations to Delphine Pashoon on what was a successful title defense of her WBC lightweight title. Moving on, we come to the Shawnee Monaghan versus Calum Johnson light heavyweight fight. And this is a fight that worked out exactly as I expected. This is what I predicted, that given the implementation of both fighters and how neither one is really defensively blessed, they're just not those kinds of fighters. These are offense guys. These are punchers that are prone to mixing it up within close proximity to each other. That neither fighter is defensively blessed in a situation like that tends to favor the younger fighter. The younger fighter who in this case also happened to be the bigger puncher. You know, Calum Johnson started off throwing some heavy leather out there, and there was very little that Shawnee Monaghan could do to work around it. There was very little that he could do about it aside from trying to weather the storm and absorb it. He got dropped 2 times in the second round, and ultimately the ref chose to wave it off in the third. You know, Calum Johnson is one of these guys who maybe he doesn't have elite level skills per se, but he does have elite level power. And a guy like that is not a guy you can afford to be lackadaisical around. He's not the kind of guy you can afford to take chances with, because if something gets through, he can hurt you.
Shawnee found that out.
And that's why this fight lived up to my expectations, because I didn't figure that Shawnee Monaghan's got the defensive prowess to work around that kind of punching power when a guy's so young, he's so aggressive, and he's packing that kind of a punch. So, you know, there's no surprises here. The most I'm left thinking is how much I'd like to see Calum Johnson take on Joe Smith Jr. And we'll get to Joe Smith Jr.'s fight, but that's what I'm left thinking post-fight, that I'd like to see a matchup between those two guys, because they're both tough guys, they've both been in there with high-level fighters, and they both pack a respectable punch. I dare say that that makes for a sizzling fight between the two fighters, even though there's not a world title involved.
That could honestly be one of the most fan-friendly fights the entire light heavyweight division could produce, because you know that both guys are punchers, and you know that they're both tough-as-nails guys. Joe Smith Jr. in particular, I mean, look at the level of competition that he's faced, win or lose, and process that this guy's never even been dropped. Just imagine how a tough-as-nails guy like that, with his own kind of power, matches up against a guy like Calum Johnson, who's also a tough guy, who also packs a sizable punch. That's what I'm left thinking most post-fight, that I would love to see a matchup between those two guys. So for now, you know, congratulations to Calum Johnson, but needless to say, this is what I expected. I expected him to blast through Shawnee Monaghan, and that's what he did.
Then there is the case of Maurice Hooker versus Mikel Lespierre. A very curious performance, because there was definitely something hampering Maurice Hooker's ability. There was definitely something bothering him throughout the fight, and yet it was still a dominant showing. And in hindsight, it leaves you with the impression that if Maurice Hooker were really at 100% in the fight, it would not have gone the distance, because this was a dominant showing throughout, and this was a Maurice Hooker that was being hampered by something. Maybe it was the weight cut. You know, he had to make several attempts before he actually made the weight for the fight. Had he not made the weight, he would have lost the title on the scales, but he managed to make the weight, but it seemed to have taken a physical toll on him, because in the fight, something was definitely bothering him. I'll tell you though, I was thoroughly impressed with Maurice Hooker in this fight. I was thoroughly impressed that in spite of being physically hampered by something, he was able to exhibit not only a dominant showing, but actual growth as a fighter. Understand that Maurice Hooker has become synonymous with giving up his height to smaller fighters. That can be dangerous, because that can leave you subject to those fighters' power. And yet in this fight, Maurice Hooker exhibited a good measuring jab, that he was using to multitask, to not only measure the distance between himself and Mikel Lespierre, but also set up the straight right hand. The right hand, which he landed several times.
On Mikel Lespierre.
I mean, he threw the goddamn punch so many times, it seems like he couldn't miss this guy.
The performance impressed me for a few reasons. One, because we see that something's wrong with Maurice Hooker, but he's still able to dominate this guy. He's still able to show that he's a cut above this kind of guy, that even though he's not 100% right now, that's not going to be a segue, that's not going to be a door for this guy to get back in this fight. Because in spite of this, Maurice Hooker's controlling all the action, throwing most of the punches and landing most of the punches, upstairs and downstairs. There really should have been 2 knockdowns in this fight. You know, if you're gonna go off of what's official, it'll say that there's 1 knockdown, but it should have been 2, because Maurice Hooker landed 2 very good shots to Mikel Lespierre upstairs, and Mikel Lespierre hit the deck. Later on in the fight, Maurice Hooker landed a body shot, which folded up Mikel Lespierre, caused him to, you know, buckle. He almost didn't make the count. Now, I was surprised he was able to get up from that, because this is at the highest level that Mikel has ever competed. He's never quite fought at this level, against this level of an opponent. And then there was the situational awareness of Maurice Hooker. You know, to Mikel Lapierre's credit, he tried in spots to get into this fight, to get back into this fight, I should say. He tried, but in those moments, Maurice Hooker quickly brought him, you know, back down to earth by absorbing those shots on the arms, on the gloves, and then firing combinations of his own, effectively putting Mikel back in his place, sealing off his opportunities to find his way into this fight. And I said this in my prediction video, that I didn't always have a high opinion of Maurice Hooker, but fight by fight, he has shown growth. He has shown improvement. He has shown that he can travel to hostile territory and win a world title. And he can travel to hostile territory and defend that same world title. Here he showed that even if he's a little under the weather, even if he is physically impaired, he is still able to successfully defend that world title against an undefeated fighter. This is the fourth undefeated fighter in a row that Mighty Mo Hooker has dished out their first professional loss to. So I'm more and more impressed with this guy. He's making me a believer. I can only hope that whatever happened for this camp, you know, him struggling to make the weight, I can only hope that that was an acute situation, because I look forward to seeing more of him in the 140-pound division. There are any variety of fights with the other champions, some that are champions and some that are soon to be crowned champions. There are other situations there that I would relish the opportunity to see Mighty Mo Hooker in, and I look forward to seeing those opportunities. I would hate to see the guy leave the division without having fought at least one of those other champions, because I'm very impressed with this guy. So congratulations to Maurice Hooker. Now, I did anticipate that he would win this fight by way of knockout, but what I didn't anticipate is that he'd be feeling under the weather the night of the fight. Nevertheless, I picked him to win the fight, and that's what he did, in dominant fashion. Now, in the case of the Dmitry Bivol versus Joe Smith Jr. fight, this was basically an iteration of things that we already knew. We already knew that Dmitry Bivol is a more nuanced, a more fluid, a more skillful boxer than Joe Smith Jr. That if Joe Smith Jr. has any kind of out in this fight, it's his punching power. But that devastating punching power can be offset by the skills of Dmitry Bivol. That Dmitry Bivol, being the athletic and malleable fighter that he is, Joe Smith Jr.'s power alone, it's not going to be enough to win him this fight. Now, I will say, to Joe Smith Jr.'s credit, he gave a good account of himself. He gave a testament to just how tough he is, because I picked Bivol to win this fight by way of knockout, and Joe Smith Jr. actually finished the fight on his feet. He heard the final bell, so that's a credit to him. But I'm not the least bit surprised that Bivol put on a dominant, skillful showing against Joe Smith Jr. when we all know that Joe, you know, he's a tough guy, he's got his virtues, but he's really not the most skilled boxer, and the skills gap alone was enough for me to pick Bivol to win. It's what made him the logical choice. Wasn't necessarily blown away by how Bivol looked, more along the lines of, it was an iteration of things that I already knew. Bivol is a much better boxer than Joe Smith Jr.
Mm-hmm.
And that's what he put on display with his movement, with his jab, with his small adjustments, nuances, like throwing off a shot, then taking a small step back, but not such a big step that you're far out of range, too far to counter, but not being in range enough that you're in line for punches. You know, these are the kinds of small things, subtleties, that Dmitry Bivol possesses. So, you know, I'm not the least bit surprised that the guy won the fight.
Not at all.
Now, I will say, given Joe Smith Jr.'s performance and the fact that he was able to hang in there in spite of being clearly dominated, I would still like to see this guy in situations. I still think he has the capability to put on very good shows for the paying public. And one possibility is a Calum Johnson fight, which I iterated earlier in the video, that given both of those guys' implementation, a fight between them would be a barn burner. It could be a classic, a Gatti versus Ward kind of fight, because they're both punchers, they both like to come forward. Neither one of them is defensively blessed, so you're not going to get a lot of moving around the ring and a lot of posturing. You're going to get a firefight. Given how Joe performed against Bivol, the fact he was able to hang in there, I still think there are opportunities out there for him to make some cash, and that's one of those opportunities. I hope that the people over there at Matchroom USA, I hope the people over there at The Zone, are considering that as a possibility for Calum Johnson's next fight, because I think they could entertain a lot of people with a fight between him and Joe Smith Jr. So, my post-fight reaction to Bivol versus Smith Jr., not a lot of surprises, you know, I mean, it's what I thought would happen, more or less, minus the knockout, but Bivol won, and that's what I thought would happen. Moving on to a more controversial fight, a fight that isn't being digested very well
In some circles, the fight between WBC welterweight champion Sean Porter and challenger Yordanis Ugas. It appears that there are a lot of people out there that don't agree with the judge's decision, that don't agree that Sean Porter should have got the nod, should have got the decision. And I'll tell you this much, I'm not one of those people. The fight that I saw, at minimum, the fight that I saw looked a lot like a draw. And in a draw situation, the champion would in fact retain his title. So at minimum, even though I myself feel that the fight looked more like a draw than a Yordanis Ugas win, the same applies. Sean Porter would still keep his title in the event of a draw. I want you guys to understand something. The way the fight looked to me, it looked a lot to me like Yordanis Ugas was fighting a reactionary kind of fight, feeding off of Sean Porter's movements, attempting to read him, to anticipate his movements to counter in kind. And in a situation like this, that's not the way to go about it. Remember, you're the challenger, challenging the champion. You've got to bring that fight to him. You can't allow him to set the tempo and the pace of the fight by reacting to whatever he does, because if he's not doing much, then you're not doing much. And there was plenty of that in this fight on both sides. A lot of measuring, a lot of posturing, you know, trying to anticipate the other guy's movements. I mean, on one end, you might have Sean, who's looking for an entry point, a safe entry point, to where he won't get tagged coming in when he goes to land a combination. In turn, Yordanis Ugas anticipates those movements and responds with movements of his own. And they were effectively offsetting each other in spots to the point where the action is far and few at times. They met each other and traded at times, and other times they simply measured each other. But the effort was not so lopsided on either side of the spectrum that I can say that Yordanis Ugas won this fight or Porter clearly won this fight. It looked a lot like a draw to me, and in a draw situation, the champion would go home with his belt. So, myself, I'm not in agreement with any claims of a robbery, because the aesthetic of this fight overall was that of a close fight. I didn't see either one of these guys imposing his will on the other. I will say, however, that in the case of Yordanis Ugas, if you're the challenger and he's the champion, you've got to operate on the assumption that any rounds that may be too close to call might go to the champion. It's your job to put a stamp on it, to put forth the effort that makes it a decisive victory. Because I know you're not walking in here expecting to get the close rounds when he's the champion and you're the challenger. You know, those are my thoughts. Now, I will say that I did pick Sean Porter to win a close points decision. I entertained the possibility that Ugas could make things very difficult for him, but my official prediction was Sean Porter on points, and the prediction stuck. But I will say that, in hindsight, the fight looked like a draw to me. That is what it looked like. If that's any consolation to you guys out there who think that maybe Ugas should have got the decision. You know, I myself didn't see that. Ugas did not impose his will on Sean Porter. He not from where I was sitting, but it did look like a draw to me, if that's any consolation.